the photographs which you are seeing here is an amazing photograph of 1830s. It's actually from the Basel Mission archive. People in the photographs which you are seeing is an people from the tile factory. So they're all very happy receiving a gold medal for their product. And the photograph which you are seeing, the next one, is a safe locker actually designed by the Swiss German missionaries, you know, 200 years back. And when you see this whole idea in a contemporary perspective, it's very amazing. The sculpture which you are seeing around is actually titled Hatha Yoga. So they have a huge collection of Hatha Yogis. These Hatha Yogis are actually a clay models made in, you know, colonial period. So under the guidance of the British officer. So when you think as a medium, a terracotta, it passes through all the extremes. It goes into, you know, the clay becomes wet and it's dried and it gets into a shape, and then, you know, it goes into oven and it's burned, and then, you know, it passes through so many stages and so many, you know, extremes. Something similar to Hatha Yoga. The intention of Hatha Yoga is also same, to prolong your life, to prolong your, you know, lifespan. So all these associations really, you know, makes you think a different time is neither past nor, you know, today. It creates a kind of a new space called fifth dimension.
This, like all of my other works, is about the kind of fault lines or the kinds of things that happen between two groups of people, or the exaggerated anxiety which may not really need to exist. And so this is like almost like a surreal, imaginative work, or almost as if somebody's gone completely hysterical and has sat down over months winding the border, which is actually the case. And it also is a reflection upon the actual hysteria, that how is it that you can fence a border between communities which have existed much longer than countries which are just barely, like the oldest country is barely 200 years old. This particular work, it's rather simple. It's made out of an everyday object which we see around ourselves, which is a balloon. And what I've done is I've added just a small text. It's mass produced, and it's a handwritten text printed onto the balloon that says, "I want to live with no fear." I mean, the work is triggered with these kinds of events and the kind of change in human perception since in the past 10 years, where we live in a heightened state of security. And here there is a kind of aspiration where you have in a balloon which is floating upwards, "I want to live with no fear," but we also know there is gas in it, you know, and the fact that it would deflate. And so there is a sense of loss also associated with it. And what happens is that all these balloons are given to people to carry and walk around in streets. So in a way, there's also some kind of relationship as to what, in terms of ownership and association with a work of art. Or there have been times when people have taken this balloon and passed it around, or the balloon sort of sits in people's homes. So it's also about this kind of transformation of your understanding with an object when it moves into different spaces, be it the gallery or the street or a domestic space, and then the afterlife that it might take on. You know, in the end, it also just becomes, it loses its body, it just loses itself.
We'll be right back. I use the material in thorny bamboo, bamboo strip and gunny cloth mud. I use this material and create the artwork. The audience will go and interact my artwork. So interaction in the sense when they put the head inside and that the space to leave all bad memories and bad thoughts and come back. So end of the biennial, I want to burn the whole artwork. That's the idea of burning all bad things. This is the project known to Hano. The art material is unclaimed human body ash. Then I thought, I mean, just as a human being, I want to do something for the souls. Then I went to the office and I asked the permission to get the ashes. I've taken the ashes in my wall. I did it the dots. That each dot I'm considered like a family of one single person, and I did on the wall. And I collected the spade. With that, I made it a light torch. When the audience will come, that take the torch and come inside, because the inside is completely dark. Either knowingly or unknowingly, with the torch, the audience will give them respect for those souls. So this is the way I want to make myself to for unknown souls. I did this project.
Hi.
Ah, tell me.
Mr. Raja?
Yes.
Neera.
Tell me, Neera, what is it?
I sent you an SMS, and I've been speaking to Kari, so I just thought what they're saying is that you should be there. Media generally is saying that you should be there because of the the Dalit dispensation, all that, the Dravidian, the party and all that. Saying that the leader...
So I think in the case of the Radia tapes, I mean, quite frankly, they provided a very felt and very profound, in a way, experience of what was wrong with the Indian media and their relationships with corporations, politics, and so on.
And to be able to first distill the Radia tapes, archive them, transcribe them, and read them in a certain chronology actually provided you with the perfect ingredients in dramaturgy and setting to write a screenplay. And to give it this garb of fiction, right? It's a threat of a film. Are we going to make a film starring Barkha and Ranjan Bhattacharya and Veer Sanghvi and so and so? No. But it's given that form. It's dressed up in this way with these settings. It's for you to decide, are these fictitious settings? Are these real settings? Are these really the Radia tapes? Did the artist actually edit it and add more masala or not? That this is where the archive then becomes important. You're unwittingly a voyeur. You're part of this, we felt we were always listening in on these cross connections like we did in the 80s, in the analog days. And still you're listening to really dark stuff. And so to accompany the screenplay, we had these phone lines, which also invoked spectrum in some way. And you could pick it up and actually had an IVR phone response where you could type in the scene number and listen to its corresponding leak. You immediately feel weird because you are being this voyeur into the conversations, and yet you read on and you listen on, as I think you must.
I think Skoda is really created a win-win situation by helping or by collaborating with the Indian art community, and I think they really created a win-win situation.
What's interesting and what's exciting about this award is the kind of perspective which is just celebrating and engaging with art. Mainly, I feel the most interesting function of this award is, for me, is the kind of excitement it can create about contemporary art in a very wider, in a wider context.
Most of my projects, I'm not able to make it. One is the nature. I'm working with the nature. And that is sometime I can manage. But the financial thing, the some projects, I'm not able to make it till now. Maybe the scored up price, I mean, those who are, I mean, dream, wishes, a dream, I mean, projects can make it. This prize will help for the artist.
I guess the prize is important because we do lack other forms of art patronage. And the prize comes with a cash award that we believe many artists could put to significant uses in their own practice.